right, Malia, welcome back. It's so good to always have you here, and I'm really excited to learn about what the heck is going on in the world of health insurance. You are my go-to expert there, so I'm very excited to learn about your world today, and we can talk about some other things as well. But how's everything been with you, and what the heck is going on in the world of health insurance these days?
Doing great here, staying busy. Most of the time, or back in the day, in health insurance brokers would see a slowdown in business during summertime, but not this year, because the biggest change this year is the unwinding of Medicaid. Have you heard of that, Jason?
You know, just a little bit with talking with you, but it seems like it's actually a pretty big issue. So I thought it'd be great for us to chat about a little bit and learn, like, what is going on? You know, what should people be thinking about? And like, what are you recommending on next steps for people to deal with this?
At the beginning of the pandemic, they put in a new rule or a law saying that if you're eligible for Medicaid, then they can't kick you off. And so I had clients that at one point were making $300,000 a year. And because of the pandemic, usually self-employed people, they had to close shop. Then they temporarily lost income and qualified for Medicaid. Well, all this time, even when they reopened and went back to making $300,000-$400,000 a year, they were still eligible to stay on Medicaid. Well, that just ended in April. And so what that means is millions of people will be forced to get off Medicaid, and they will have to transition and buy their own insurance. And the Kaiser Family Foundation estimates that there are going to be up to 14 million individuals that will be affected by this.
A couple things there. So one, are people not paying for any sort of health insurance along the way, because Medicaid is generally either free or low cost? And two, when I started my business, we have Medi-Cal in California, so it's similar.
Yeah.
And so you cannot qualify for general insurance until you're making past like $30,000 or $40,000 a year or something like that. So my first couple of years in business, I was not making that, so I had to go on Medi-Cal. It was very limited on what doctors I could go to, and it was very difficult to deal with. How are you seeing that play out in the marketplace? And, you know, are people really, you know, I don't want to say taking advantage possibly, but do you think that's what's happening? Do you think it's more of they just dealt the card they were given and just follow whatever process the government gave them?
That is a really great question, Jason. So I'm glad that you asked that. And you have a really good point. In California, it's called Medi-Cal. And I used to live in California. So I remember that in California, if you're on Medi-Cal, it was really difficult to find providers that would accept you, or sometimes there's long wait periods. And so a lot of people in California, they shun the idea of having to use Medi-Cal. But in states like, for example, Idaho, my home state right now, we just expanded Medicaid just a couple years ago. And I did notice that most of the providers up here accept Medi-Cal, and it's no different than using regular insurance on the consumer side. And so the advantages of staying on Medi-Cal or Medicaid, they have different names depending on which state you're in, depends on your area. And so some people are anxious to get off of Medicaid, but then some people are just staying on until they get kicked off.
Okay. And just so everybody understands, Medicaid generally, you have to be making a very low income to qualify for that in the first place. So if you lose your job or your business and you go to zero, obviously that qualifies. I know it's a range, but do you happen to know what range that might be for people to qualify for Medicaid? And if not, that's
yeah. So first of all, Medicaid guidelines are different depending on the state. So if you're in a state that expanded Medicaid, then as long as you're under 138% federal poverty level, then you will qualify to stay on Medicaid. So remember that if you're self-employed, they're gonna go off of your net income. So you could be making, you know, $100,000 a year, but if you have all these business expenses that drop you below that income limit, you qualify. And so yes, in the states that expanded Medicaid, it's easy. It's just a matter of income. Now, in states, there's a few states that have not expanded Medicaid, just off the top of my head. It's going to be like Texas or Florida. What those states have determined is, hey, if you're an able-bodied working person, even if you don't make that much money, then you don't qualify for Medicaid unless you're pregnant or you're at at home caring for a young child or you have cancer. So there's extra steps in order to qualify for Medicaid.
Okay. Yeah, I think the income in California is around $22,000 or so below. I think federal poverty level is around $16,000. Don't quote me on that, but somewhere around mm-hmm. that range. But I think some states is as low as like $12,000 a year, possibly, because cost of living is much lower there. So my point of asking that is, there's probably a lot of people that make more than that wouldn't qualify, but they stayed on this whole time for what, 3 years now at this point. So they're probably going to have a significant increase in medical costs, is what it sounds like.
That does bring me to a question I've been meaning to ask you. So it's no secret that the key to getting affordable insurance, if you have to buy it on your own, is to keep your income low, correct? So that's where I would refer the client to ask their financial advisor and ask them, hey, as a financial advisor, Jason, what are some of the tax income strategies that you help your clients with in order to manage your income and remain within the limits so they qualify for that subsidy?
Yeah, so that's a really good question. So when I deal with this type of question, it's usually for two separate types of clients. One is going to be that self-employed business owner generally that has to provide their own insurance. And the other one is going to be that early retiree that wants to retire prior to when they qualify for Medicare and they don't qualify through another means like a disability or something like that. So there's going to be two different routes, but overall things are generally similar. So like you mentioned, it is based on net income, right? So if you're a business owner, there are a multitude of ways to manipulate your income. One is to use a retirement plan, potentially to do tax deferred contributions. You could potentially accelerate expenses if you have other expenses that are potentially on the books for you this year, or you could do next year, you might want to accelerate those. You also might want to think about when you are collecting invoices, because if you are running your business on a cash basis, then that income is going to count when you receive it. So these are all things that maybe you want to, it's December and you have a potentially a big sale coming in or a big commission. Maybe you want to receive that in January to then move that income forward. That could be a couple ideas there. For the retiree, depending on how they set themselves up prior to retirement, then it can get really interesting. And this is where I really encourage people, if you're within 10 years of retirement, to get with an advisor that really understands how to help you plan for this. Because if you want to retire early, yes, it may make the most sense from a current tax perspective to put all your money in a pre-tax account because you're going to get that tax deduction today, right? So that is nice if you used a traditional IRA, traditional 401k or 403b or traditional TSP. But if you get towards those retirement years and you don't have any other money set aside, and I like to call them the three buckets, okay? So we want to have some money in tax deferred, which would be like the traditional 401k/IRA. Some money in tax-free, which would be a Roth account of some sort, like an after-tax Roth 401k or Roth IRA. And the third bucket would be a taxable account. So that could be something like your bank accounts or just a brokerage account where you can still invest the money, but that money would only be subject to capital gains at that point if you were to sell off some of your investments, if you needed that money ahead of time. So if we have money from each of those buckets available, then this is where I can say, hey, Malia, what income level do we need to keep this client at for them to qualify for their subsidy? And I'll usually ask for a couple different levels, right? If it's 60,000 or 80,000 or 100, because correct me if I'm wrong, but usually depending on their income level, they can get an extra amount of subsidy depending on where their income is. But they might get some subsidy even if they're higher versus more subsidy if they're lower. So then we need to look at what is the short-term versus long-term game plan for this client, right? Because if we optimize solely for insurance, and we save $100 a month, for example, right? Versus optimizing for taxes, where if they paid a little bit more insurance this year, but we can do an advanced technique called a Roth conversion and move some money from their pre-tax accounts to their Roth accounts. And now that money's gonna grow forever tax-free. We need to really look at what makes the most sense for that particular client. So some of the things we can look at, as we mentioned, is it's called retirement income planning, where we time the income from different accounts appropriately to try to target that desired income level. And this is something that most people don't have to do for more than a few years. And you know, ideally it is beneficial on both sides of the coin, but I have seen people basically, you know, not spend money early, not go on vacations, not live their life solely to save a small amount of money on insurance. And there's a tax situation, but there's also a life situation, right?
So, good point.
Yeah, it's like, okay, if you're 60 years old or 62 years old, and you are focusing on saving money on insurance for the first 3 to 5 years of your retirement, those could be possibly your most healthy years, your best years overall. So sometimes I'll tell people, hey, let's go up a bracket so that you can have the lifestyle that you want if they don't have enough money in any of those, you know, all three of those buckets, because the far majority of people mostly have their money in a pre-tax, you know, IRA account. So this is where I really like your idea of us, you know, someone like you and like me working together on the strategy, because we need to balance the cost of insurance with the cost of not living their best life early, or the cost of setting themselves up for a potentially worse tax situation in the future by not optimizing all their different opportunities there. So I know that's a lot, but this is how the brain of a financial advisor works that focuses on retirement planning. This is a lot to think about.
This is why I always tell my clients to refer to their tax or their financial advisor, because these are all things to consider that, you know, people don't think about. And you're right about, hey, in the last year or so, I've had a few clients that retire and within a month they were gone. So things to consider. But that does bring me to another question too. We're talking about income wise, because usually by the time they get to me for their Medicare needs, it's kind of too late. They had to have planned this years in advance, right? Their income. So I wanted to ask you about the IRMA surcharges, which is the income related monthly adjustment amount. That's the amount that Social Security charges extra for the premiums for higher income earners. So how can your clients effectively plan for retirement income to avoid or reduce the IRMA surcharges?
Yeah, that's a good question. So most people, if they're married and both spouses are alive, okay, and let's just be blunt with it, their income has to be over $194,000 gross, modified adjusted gross income, to have a problem with this. So it's not usually while folks are alive that they have this issue. It's when they go from a joint filer tax bracket to a single filer tax bracket, or if it's just a single person retiring that is filing taxes as a single filer, that they usually run into a bigger potential issue. So at that point, the limit to not suffer a penalty from IRMA is $97,000 per year. Okay, so if they're gonna earn over $97,000 per year, and that is all income, okay? That includes their Social Security, pensions, distributions from IRAs. Then they're gonna enter into that IRMA surcharge territory, where it can start off around close to $900 a year, and that would be a 2-year penalty. Anytime you hit it, it's gonna be for the following 2 years, and it's based on the income from the prior year, generally, right? And so if they are over, then they could potentially pay at least, you know, high $800, close to $900 per year for 2 years. So that's about $1,800 to $1,900. Or if they go higher than that, it could be $3,000 or even $5,000 per year. So this strategy is something I talk to a lot about with married couples, because we call this the widow penalty, okay? That if somebody were to pass away and they become a widow, not only do they lose the Social Security benefit potentially of that second spouse, they're losing income there. And that income is taxed more efficiently, by the way, than an IRA distribution. they're also potentially going to go up tax brackets. And so if you have a large pre-tax account, like an IRA or 401k, and then you get to your required minimum distribution age of 73 or 75, potentially depending if you're born 1960 or later, it's not that difficult for somebody who has a moderately large IRA to enter into IRMA income penalty territory. So this planning, you know, ideally should start prior to retirement for the same reasons we're talking about here about qualifying for health insurance and getting that subsidy, but also for later in retirement so that they can avoid the IRMA penalties. And, you know, I get a lot of people saying, maybe you can tell me if you hear the same thing. I get a lot of people say, well, why does this have to be so complicated?
Mm-hmm. Right? Absolutely.
Why does it have to be so complicated? And it's like, I can totally appreciate that. But at the same time, if you understand how to leverage the different tools and systems we have available and take advantage of them, then it could be better for you overall, right? And that's part of the challenge, where there are good and bad, pros and cons, you know, to everything. So One thing that I think about is going back to their distribution strategy, right? Mm-hmm. On how they're going to distribute from their accounts post-retirement. That's a really important thing to think about. Planning for healthcare is part of that, but that goes back to the equation. Well, okay, if we don't get any income this year by leaving our IRAs alone, right, and we qualify for the subsidy on our healthcare, but then those accounts grow the next 2, 3, 4, or 5 years, for example, pre-tax, and now at 65, we now have to start distributing from those accounts to fund our needs, or later after 73 to take a required distribution, is that going to cost us thousands of dollars more than just paying for the extra cost of the insurance today?
Yeah, that's a lot to think about. And, you know, it's hard for people to think that far ahead, but they need to look out for that.
Yeah. And, you know, getting the education is one thing, but, you know, to be honest, getting the advice that you need from a good retirement planner, I just truly believe that's going to be worth it. But you want to have somebody that's going to work with a team, like we're talking about here, is how do we strategize together to find the best bang for the buck for that particular client, right? So on your side for Medicare, on the Medicare side, I did want to ask a little bit about what you're seeing there, because I get a lot of questions about people saying, well, what other options should I take besides Part A, Part B, and maybe Part D? Can you share any insights there on some things to think about around that, maybe versus Advantage plans versus the traditional, anything there?
We are seeing a higher trend on seniors going for the Advantage plans. They are getting more popular these days, especially because due to all the inflation and the cost of groceries and fuel, people on fixed incomes are being pinched, right? So if you go with Original Medicare and add a supplement, you have the freedom to choose your doctors. You don't have to worry about, for the most part, medical bills if things go wrong. But if you go with an Advantage plan, they will save you money, right? So most Advantage plans are free, and a lot of them are even offering help with your Part B premiums as well. There's added benefits such as dental, vision, and hearing, gym memberships that Original Medicare won't cover. So they are getting more attractive and stepping up to the plate. However, I wonder how much longer that will be, you know, like with the, if something major happens, then the safety net, which is the max out of pocket, may start to increase over time. So something to think about. There is a major changes that are coming down the pipeline with prescription coverage though. And that's kind of important, because if you're on Medicare, the medical side, the health side of it is very well covered, but the prescription part of it is terrible. And so there is light at the end of the tunnel though, because starting next year, 2024, once you are done and through with the dreaded donut hole, and we'll talk about what that donut hole is, then there's no co-insurance or co-pay that you are required to pay after that. And so have you heard of the dreaded donut hole? by your clients?
I have, yeah. So, but I would love to hear more about that from you and what you're seeing.
Yeah, so all Medicare Part D plans are set up like this. So you can't really avoid it, but there's different stages to your drug coverage. And depending on the stage that you're in, you're going to either pay a large chunk or a low chunk. And I don't know why they make it so complicated, like you mentioned before, but basically you have the deductible stage. And right now for 2023, the max deductible is $505. Usually the deductible only applies to heavy duty drugs, like brand drugs. Then once you go into the next stage, then the insurance company picks up a large chunk of that bill and you pay that small copay. Once you and your insured, your insurance carrier reaches to a certain amount, so $4,600 for 2023, then now you enter what's called the dreaded donut hole. And that is where you have to pay 25% of your medication, which can be horrific. And so this is the part that people talk about when they are on major brand drugs. Once you hit a certain amount, like $7,400, not what you pay, but between you and the insurance carrier pays, then you're out of the donut hole and your insurance company starts picking up a large chunk again. So 2024, once you get out of the donut hole, you don't have to worry about co-pays or co-insurance. And then 2025, there is a $2,000 cap of out-of-pocket expenses. So just if you're on expensive drugs, hang in there. And I know people are probably wondering, well, wouldn't that make the premiums on drugs skyrocket? It probably will. However, there is a cap on the rate increases on the drug plan premiums up to 6% starting in 2024. So those are the big things that are affecting Medicare recipients.
And that was from the Inflation Reduction Act, right?
That is correct.
You gotta love the names of these things because, again, it's probably gonna help some people, but like you said, they had to put a cap on the increase because they know it's gonna raise costs over time, which that's gonna hurt people that don't maybe qualify for the cap and they still need that drug, for example. So, you know, it's gonna cause some sort of inflation somewhere generally. It's normally how things work there.
I do believe that it is subsidized. And so, you know, taxpayers might see an increase as a result of that.
Yeah, that's what I meant. Yeah, so it's gonna get spread around, right?
Yes.
But the cap for, you know, those individuals on those expensive medications is probably gonna be really nice to their pockets, because I have heard those cases and you heard those cases as well, where people are making choices between getting medication and possibly eating properly or living, you know, in a place they want to live versus not having options there. So overall, you know, it's a challenging situation, but it sounds like it's going to help a good chunk of people there. So 2025, you said that kicks in, right?
2025 is where the $2,000 cap goes into play. Yeah. So that does bring me to another question I've been meaning to ask you was, so how do you see Social Security's financial health and potential future changes to the program affecting individuals' retirement planning?
Okay, this is a question I get all the time. Okay, I get this question all the time. And a lot of people are very concerned about Social Security, okay? Mm-hmm. The short answer for me is I'm not that concerned, but I will say we should expect tax increases probably along the way. Okay, so the current projection for Social Security is that we can fund it at our current levels through 2033 or 34, depending on what report that you read. And then at that point, the monthly benefit would have to be reduced about 20 to 22% for it to be sustainable. So a lot of people think it's like this fund that's just gonna disappear and Social Security is gonna be gone, especially young people. Young people, I hear all the time say, well, I'm gonna plan for it not to be there. And I really don't think that's appropriate, but I would say, we need to plan for how the adjustments are going to be made so that the program can be sustainable, right? And I've done some research into this and actually read the trustees report last year, that, or this year, I should say, that came out for 2022. And they have some options in there that I think could be okay. But one of the primary ones is a tax increase, okay? And so right now, we're both self-employed, right? So we pay the 6.2% for the employee side, and we pay the 6.2% for the employer side. And you pay your employees 6.2% on their side, right? And they pay the other 6.2 on of their own. So that means you and I are paying 12.4% of our income to Social Security, up to about $160,000, $160,200 this year. After that, then that is no longer required to be paid. So a couple ideas are: increase the amount of income that tax is required to be paid on. So that would potentially fix it, but there's not a lot of people that make a high income, right? So the other ideas, that donut hole you mentioned, where you have a $160,000 200 stop, and then at $400,000 or more, then you start paying again that 6.2%. Again, it's such a small impact because so few people make that level of income overall. But if they were to raise the tax as a whole, about 1.8% from what the report I read, then we can sustain the program about another 75 years without any cuts at that point. Okay.
Interesting.
Yeah. And a couple other ideas, which I like this idea. Okay. This is the idea I would support the most, is currently the trust fund is invested in like 100% secure government bonds, right? That's great and everything because it's secure. But why don't we take advantage of the power of American Industries and put a portion of that trust fund into, let's say, the S&P 500, the top 500 companies in the US. It hasn't returned every single year forever, but the average over time has been about a 10% return on the S&P 500. So one of the proposals I noted on, you can actually read this on the trustees report on the site, is that they're thinking about putting somewhere around 40% to 60% of that trust fund into some equities to have it professionally managed, and just like an index fund type of deal where you can have it invested in the top big companies. That could be potentially really good, and another way to help it be sustaining that would alleviate some of that tax, okay?
Yeah, I'd be for that.
I would be for that too. It is risk, okay? There is risk to that because that money can be volatile. But as long as it's managed properly, it's just like managing a retirement portfolio at the end of the day, right? We need to keep enough money safe for a long enough period. So let's say even 10 years, right? To keep that money safe worth of trust fund. But then money we don't need for 10 years or 20 years or more, why can't we invest that in American industry? Because it's not like we're going to go to zero here. We have the most powerful economy in the world. The United States stock market is about 60% of the global stock market. Okay, so it's a huge portion of that. And in all honesty, you know, if you raise that 1.8%, and on the self-employed, that would be 3.6. On someone that makes $100,000 income, which, by the way, the low-income numbers came out recently for California here for LA and Orange County, okay? So you're considered low-income in Los Angeles if you make less than about $72,000 in that range.
Oh, wow.
Okay, you're considered low-income. And if you make less than $80,000 in Orange County, you're considered low-income. Right?
Wow.
So to make the numbers easy, let's just say you make $100,000 as a household, okay? Two $50,000 earners, which again, that's low moderate income. If you raise taxes on that group and they're self-employed, that would be 3.6%. That's $3,600 per year, right? You know, if I had the choice, I personally would say, hey, let's do a forced retirement contribution, right? Like a forced Roth IRA or a forced 401k that is then invested in equities for each of those people, that will generally provide a stream of retirement income for them over time, but you control that and you own that, and that can be passed on, whereas Social Security doesn't.
Yes.
Right, so that's my idea. If you wanna raise it, let's do a forced savings that goes into account you can't touch until Social Security age, maybe at 62, for example. Versus taking that out of people's tax money today for something they may not even receive if they were to pass away, let's say at an early age. So sustainability, I don't think is a big issue, but there are gonna have to be adjustments around taxation or how the trust fund is handled. But I don't think it's gonna go to zero. And so anybody worried about that, it could be for me and you though, by the way. The full retirement age now 67. That was raised prior. It was is in the 66 and it was a 65, I think, when it first started. So that could go up for us until 70, you know, and they could expect us to work longer.
Have you heard anything about how the birth rates are affecting this? Because economists are saying that, you know, back in the olden days, you know, the earlier generations were having an average of like 4 kids, and now we're down to like 1.5 kids or something like that.
Yeah. So let's get controversial on this, okay? Because this is, I actually did this research and looked into what's going on here with Social Security. So the birth rate does come into play, okay? So we're not at a sustainable birth rate at this point in our country, right? Mm-hmm. Obviously, there's a lot of talk in the news about how much immigration has been happening in our country, okay? When I looked at this Social Security trustees report last year, I saw something very interesting that at the time I didn't quite know what was going on, but like it just struck me as weird, okay? So when mm-hmm. you look at the reports and you can see on average people that come in from immigration, right? And they talk about, you know, undocumented or documented, like illegally or legally, okay? And so each year for the prior years, on average, we would get somewhere 300,000 to 500,000 people that would come in, sometimes 600,000 that are undocumented, okay? Mm. Those workers, when they work here, they pay into Social Security, but they don't necessarily get the benefit of Social Security. So this is a controversial point where some people say, hey, if you paid into the system, you should get, you know, the benefits over time. But that's not the case, you know, currently. Hmm. So what happens with those people, if on average 500,000 people come in, about 300,000 of those immigrants will end up going back to their country and never collect on Social Security.
Oh, wow.
Okay. The other 200,000 do. They become citizens or they qualify somehow, you know, through work visas or whatnot. And so net, the Social Security Trust Fund grows because they have people contributing that never claim, right?
Oh, wow.
So something, again, this is my conspiracy theory. I fully admit that. But part of what I'm thinking is for this extreme amount of immigration that's coming in, because we're having a lot more immigration than we've ever had in the past, is one of the things that the politicians in charge are trying to do is help shore up that Social Security Trust Fund, because they know on average 60% of people that end up, you know, working here, I guess you call it illegally or undocumented, mm-hmm. are never going to claim their Social Security benefit, which then helps out that birth rate issue you were talking about.
Oh, wow. That's interesting.
Right. So, yeah. You know, there's more to what meets the eye than just simply the numbers. But again, this is my conspiracy theory, and this is me actually reading through that report and seeing. Another thing I'll mention is when I read the report, it skipped a year or two. And I don't quote me on this exactly number of years, but it went from like an average of like 500,000 coming in undocumented to 1.2 million. Right. Mm. That's what they were like expecting on this report. That's how they were, projecting the report on how long it would last. So I think this was something that was planned, by the way, to increase this immigration. But that was all what I read in that Social Security Trustees report. So this is going to be very controversial and, you know, it just is what it is. And I love the immigrants. Yeah, I love the immigrants. They do a great job. You know, I have nothing against them. All I'm saying is these are the numbers and the facts that I'm putting together from my research.
Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah, but good question, but took a little bit of a different turn than you probably thought it was going to go to, right?
Yeah, that was actually the first I've heard of that, but it makes sense, actually, your theory. One other question for you, this is kind of for my own benefit too, is I noticed that the other day you uploaded the how to correct your Social Security earnings record to your coach. Retirement coach Facebook group. So can you tell me more about that and why it's important to review your earnings and make sure that it's accurate?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So for anybody that doesn't know, is watching this outside, we have a free Facebook group called Your Retirement Coach, where I upload and share a lot of resources. So I recently uploaded not only this document, but a bunch of other documents and links and sites to help with retirement issues and a lot of that were around Social Security. So this one specifically Malia asked about was a document that shows you how to correct your earnings record if it is wrong, okay? So we all love and know the government and trust them overall, okay? But to be honest, there's mistakes that are made sometimes on people's earnings records for Social Security. And the way your Social Security benefit is calculated is based on your top 35 earning years, okay? So if you don't work 35 full years, then you get what are called 0 years, and that really does impact your benefit and brings it down. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, if those earnings are not correct, then when that calculation is done for what's called your PIA, your primary insurance amount that you would receive at full retirement age, then you could potentially be missing out on what's technically owed to you, right? So by reviewing your record regularly, then you're gonna be able to go in there and catch those mistakes early. It mm-hmm. is something that if someone's going to retire before they claim, I normally recommend that they do, but it's not like it's fun to contact Social Security and you wanna deal with all the headaches of waiting for all that. So if you just can log into your account, you can create an account on ssa.gov and check that at any time or any age. And I actually just recently checked into mine. It's actually pretty cool. They have a lot of different things in there now, new calculators that I didn't see a few years ago that are really, really useful. But that document I uploaded will help people figure out what they need to do if there is an incorrect amount of income and how to approach that and how to contact Social Security and what to do so that they can get their full benefits over time and really make sure they're maximizing their retirement income, which is, I mean, even a couple hundred dollars a month is $2,400 a year that gets an inflation adjustment and an increase each year that could be, you know, tens of thousands of dollars over time for retirement income. So it's a really good question and very important to make sure you're checking on that before you retire.
Yeah, don't wait till you're about ready to retire or get on Medicare, because you do have to have a certain number of credits to be eligible for Part A free premiums. So
that's true. Yeah, really good question. So but man, this is a great conversation. We got some other topics that revolve around healthcare, but can integrate some financial planning discussions and retirement planning discussions with that. So I appreciate you so much for taking the time to come on and share with us your expertise, because I really love to hear what's going on in your world, because it's kind of like a trickle down effect where if you're hearing it today, I'm probably going to be hearing about it as I'm working through with new clients that are coming on board, and we can all be more prepared and educated. So thank you so much, Malia, for taking time today.
Thank you, Jason. And thank you for all your advice on those questions I had.
Really good question. So for anybody that's interested or needs help figuring out their health insurance, either pre-retirement, switching jobs, starting businesses, or getting onto Medicare, my understanding is your company can take care of all those issues and help people make sure they get the right plan for themselves. And if so, be happy for you to share your website or the best way to contact you to find out more information.
Yes, thank you, Jason. So we are licensed in most states, and the best number to reach us is 800-850-9657. And you can find us at medigappros.com.
Awesome. Thank you, Malia. We'll see you next time. Hopefully folks enjoyed this. And if you have any questions, feel free to leave us a comment or reach out to us directly, and we're happy to help, right? Have a great day.
Thank you, Jason.